Good morning, Rutherford County. We are so blessed to have the opportunity to come to you again today. This is Word of Faith Presents, and you know, for several years now, we've had people in the church who have wonderful testimonies of what God has done in their life, and they share. And because we're a church that is committed to the principles of John 5:30, where we hear God's voice, do His will, and speak only the words that He's called us to speak, it's my deepest desire this morning that anything that I share only be what Jesus wants you to hear. That was my prayer coming in today, and it certainly is my prayer now as we address an area that has been burning on my heart that I'm calling perilous days but unshakable faith. You know, we're living in days that are not unlike that was described in Luke 21. And you know what? If you have a Bible you haven't been reading, take it off the shelf and read it, would you? It's a book that will change your life. As it says in Hebrews, God's word is alive and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It goes to the heart of every single matter, the human condition, whatever it may be, there's an answer in God's word. So as we look out today at what's happening, and especially with all of the incredible events of last week, where literally demonic powers of destruction, of lawlessness and disobedience were just unleashed for the entire world to see, we as followers of Jesus need to go back into His word and ask the question, what's really taking place? And so if you go with me to Luke 21, verse 7, here's what you'll find. They asked Him, "Teacher, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign when these things begin to happen?" And He said, "Be careful and see to it that you are not misled. For many will come in My name, appropriating for themselves the name Messiah, which belongs to Me alone, saying, 'I am He, and the time is near. Do not follow them.' When you hear of wars and disturbances, civil unrest, revolts, uprisings, do not panic, for these things must take place first, but the end will not come immediately." Then Jesus told them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be violent earthquakes, and in various places famines, and deadly and devastating pestilences." We've seen that, haven't we? "Plagues, epidemics, and there will be terrible sights and great signs from heaven. But before all these things, they will lay their hands on you and will persecute you, turning you over to the synagogues and prisons and bringing you before kings and governors for My name's sake. This will be a time and an opportunity for you to testify about Me. So make up your minds not to prepare beforehand to defend yourselves, for I will give you skillful words and wisdom which none of your opponents will be able to resist or refute. But you will be betrayed and handed over even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. And you will be continually hated by everyone because of your association with My name. But not a hair of your head will perish. By your patient endurance, empowered by the Holy Spirit, you will gain your souls." You know, in 1 Chronicles, it tells us, 12:32, there was a tribe of Issachar, men, who understood the times with knowledge of what Israel should do. That's what the cry of our heart needs to be. Jesus, we don't want to be driven by social media. We don't want to be driven by the opinion of men. We don't want to be driven by the doctrines of false religion, which are pervasive in the 450,000 churches in America. We don't want to be driven by our own sin, by our own opinions, our own perspectives, our own learning. We only want to be driven and must only be driven by what? By the eternal Word of God found where? In His Word and through His revelation that comes by His Word and through the apostles of God. It says in Scripture that He will always bring prophets and apostles. And, you know, one of the things I love about my church, and I've said this before in my testimony, I've studied under some of the most learned people in New Testament and Old Testament, people skilled in Koine Greek, in ancient Hebrew, Harvard educated, Oxford educated, Tübingen, you know, some of the best theological training in the world. But you know what? My heart wasn't right, and I wasn't born again. And as a result, I didn't have any understanding of God's word until the day my heart was radically apprehended by Jesus. And what happened? At the point I yielded my life, I believed and I received. What happened? The scales came off my eyes, and all of a sudden, a book that had only ever been a textbook for me became, in fact, a light to my path and a brilliance in my life, to the point where now I wouldn't think of making major life decisions without consulting what God has to say in His holy book. And you know, our church, Word of Faith Fellowship, all of you that have been in the county know that it has been painfully targeted for so long. We understand what abuse is, false accusation. We understand what it's like to have people lie about you. We understand what it's like to see families torn apart because there are people that just don't want to go on with Jesus and they want to attack. But you know what? In the midst of all of us, it's made us stronger. And even though my journey here has only been 3 years, I can tell you it's been the most transformative 3 years of my life. You know, highly educated in the eyes of the world, but knowing nothing until I came to a place of saying, Jesus, all I have is for you. All to Jesus I surrender. And until you reach that point, you will not find the life and the path and the hope and the health and the healing that you're looking for. You know, I often share in my testimony, I became an alcoholic later in life. I became a workaholic trying to work my way towards heaven. It wasn't too many years ago that I was sitting up in my cabin on my balcony in a little cabin, not seeing anybody for weeks at a time, communing with nature, writing poetry about what I thought was Jesus, and not realizing I was communing with devils. They were taking me over and I was becoming insane. But God allowed me through His mercy and His providence to have another chance. It says in Scripture, He won't always strive with us. Don't presume on God's mercy. He won't always strive with us. If you know truth and you reject it, you are laying over on your soul, on your spirit, on your mind, on the whole of you. You're laying over a callous against the tender works of the Holy Spirit, and it will not go well for you. I was well on my way to a path of going right to hell, and God allowed me to experience through a church that I love and through a fellowship of believers that I absolutely know I will walk lockstep with the balance of my life, allowed me to see the darkness of my heart and everything that I needed. I thought I knew Jesus, and I didn't. I had a form of godliness, but denied the power thereof, as it says in Scripture. You know, another Scripture that's been on my heart recently, because as we look at the world today, these perilous days, we can find ourselves asking the question, how can we know what's going to happen? And you know, I found a great Scripture. It's Jeremiah 11:18. It says in Jeremiah 11:18, then the Lord gave me knowledge of their plot, and I knew it. So you, O Lord, revealed their deeds to me. God will show us. Psalm 119:105 says, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now, folks, I'm going to tell you, we're moving into some days, and these aren't political statements, they're spiritual ones. We are moving into some days that are going to be extremely difficult for our nation. Now, having said that, I want to make sure you hear me say this very clearly. Don't go posting things on social media unless you know it's true. Don't become sucked in and enamored to whatever the latest conspiracy theory is, because you know what? That's not trusting Jesus, and it's not honoring Him. And I'll say it very directly. If you post something or share something or tweet or put something on Facebook and you don't know it to be true, you're as guilty as the liars that pull it together if you pass it along. A very interesting study was done by the Lilly Foundation, and what they found was 50%, two things, 50% of people who post or repost an item on Facebook, on social media, have not read the article. They've only read the headline. That's horrific. You can get sensationalized headlines, just like the National Enquirer does, and you get people that don't really know what the substance is. That's terrible. The other thing that they learned was that very few people change their opinion based on what they hear on social media. Typically, social media is a place where people of a certain opinion gravitate together, and they all jump in and have a frothy conversation. If it's not honoring Jesus, it's sin. If He hasn't called you to it, it's sin. If you don't know something is truth and you repost it, it's sin. And you know, one of the greatest days of my life was when I realized that sin is sin and it's real and we need to call it that. We deal with sin in my church. I've been dealt with many times before about attitudes and actions, but whom the Lord loves, he corrects. And if you have a person or a church or a pastor or any kind of group that doesn't deal well with correction, there's something wrong with their heart and they've cut off Jesus. That's just clearly the case. So in these perilous days that we're in, what's going to happen in the days ahead? Well, only God knows, but there's some clear warning signs. You know, they tell the story of the canary in the coal mine. The canaries would be let loose into a coal mine, and if they came back out, they knew that there weren't noxious gases. But if they didn't come back out, it meant that those mines were not safe for the miners to go into. Well, here's the facts, folks. The canaries have been released into the culture of America, and they aren't coming back, and here's a reason why. We cannot, as a nation, believe that 63 million aborted fetuses since Roe v. Wade in 1972 are somehow a matter of indifference to God. We cannot believe that God will look at a redefining of what marriage is so that men can marry men and women can marry women and somehow believe God doesn't care about that. We cannot have any sense that God looks indifferently or passively at a country that's been trying to strip away the name of God from every single vestige that we can find. You go to the old educational institutions, Harvard, Dartmouth, Yale, you know, William and Mary, these places still have concrete inscriptions that are verses and proclamations of Jesus, but there's no Jesus really being taught there at all. Instead, they become Al-Qaeda camps for an intellectualism that is very anti-God in our country. God does not look at this indifferently. I don't know if the days ahead are God's judgment. I'm not going to make any proclamations about that, but I can tell you that this is truth, that the evangelical church in America was mostly silent in the days of Roe v. Wade. It was the Catholic Church that was building a voice to say abortion is wrong. And while we've done a great job later in the decades since to try to proclaim life, and we've had a wonderful example in a president who has done the same, the reality is our country has been one that's been reckless when it comes to the Ten Commandments, when it comes to the gospel, when it comes to the standard that he's called us to for righteous living. And we cannot pretend that somehow God doesn't care about those things. There is a verse that says that when you sow the wind, you reap the whirlwind. And we have a whirlwind that's being reaped in our country. And you know what? One of the things during these perilous days, though, that gives us hope and gives us encouragement is that God has told us he's on the throne and he's given us a standard of what we need to do. Listen to what it says in Matthew 6, 19 to 21. Do not store up for yourselves material treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart, your wishes, your desires, that on which your life centers will be also. This is a great time for you to ask the question, Jesus, where are my treasures? Is it the new house I'm getting? Is it my family? Is it my job? Is it some recreational activity? Is it how well the Carolina Panthers are doing or the Charlotte Hornets are doing? If you ever realize the weighty days that we're in and how so many people in life waste their time, they waste it. It says in Scripture that our life is like the steam off of a cooking pot. We've got a beginning, a middle, and an end. If you've ever gone to a cemetery, you've got a date, a hyphen, and a date. And it's all about what we do with the hyphen. What have we done with Jesus? Have you found Jesus, as we often are asked in our church, worth the knowing? Have you made your life's purpose to understand what the book of your life is to be? Have you cried out to Jesus and said, Jesus, I want you to direct my life. I yield all of it to you. If you're somebody that labored under the misconception, the error, and the lie that salvation is as simple as raising your hand, filling out a card, getting baptized, and living like hell the rest of your life, make today the day that you say, I'm not born again. You know, the truth sets us free. You may need to say that today. I'm not born again. Well, then be about the business of crying out to Jesus to become more like him. It's what I did, and my life has been revolutionized as a result. But you know, there are also some studies that have come out. The American Heart Association had a recent study that was so interesting, saying that the incidence of myocardial infarctions, people's cardiac issues in the country, strokes and the like, are going up in part because of anxiety and fear. We have a nation that has just been overwhelmed with a tsunami of anxiety. Why? Because they don't know Jesus. We don't get stirred by people threatening us. We don't get stirred by people saying we're going to kill you. We don't get upset when people say we're going to take all your material property. They will do that. Think it not strange, it says in Scripture. And remember again what God's standard is for us. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, God did not give us a spirit of timidity or cowardice or fear, but he's given us a spirit of power and of love and of sound judgment and personal discipline, abilities that result in a calm, well-balanced mind and self-control. We are called to a different standard. We're not called to live like the world. We're called to live by a standard that Jesus said will, by definition, just as his life was, be a stumbling block to all those around us. It says in Scripture, beware if everybody thinks highly of you. If you're not living a life that's causing conviction and interest in the lives of people around you, something is terribly wrong. If you become comfortable with your life, even if you're somebody sitting in a pew, you've got a plaque up on the wall that says your family's been there for three generations. That doesn't mean anything in God's economy. What does mean something to God is when we give our whole hearts and lives to him and let him, through the power of strong prayer and deliverance, let him bring us to a place of true understanding. I cannot tell you the times I have wept late at night or early in the morning reading God's word and for the very first time having an understanding of what it means. But you know what? It's a time for courage. It's a time for courage. And without getting any kind of political machinations here, I'm going to tell you, we have a lot of people that aren't reflecting courage when it comes to current political events. We've got a lot of people jumping ship. A lot of people that are saying, you know what? I'm just going to give up. And God hasn't called us to that. He's told us to occupy until he comes. That's not a suggestion. It's a commandment. And, you know, I love doing reading on American history because this is really what churches and pastors in the county and across America need to remember. And I do a little radio program on Tuesdays and Thursdays with Jim Bishop over at WCAB, and we talk often about God's principles that were articulated in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and the founding of our country. And this was such a powerful remembrance that I want to share this with you, too, because it relates to the question during these perilous days, what should be our attitude? Well, remember this from our history. In 1775, the Lutheran pastor John Peter Gabriel Muhlenberg, there's a college in Ohio named after him, preached a sermon on Ecclesiastes 3:1, to everything. There is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. Concluding the message, he declared, in the language of Holy Writ, there is a time for all things. There is a time to preach and a time to fight, and now is the time to fight. He threw off his clerical robes to reveal the uniform of a Revolutionary Army officer. That afternoon, at the head of 300 men, he marched off to join General George Washington's troops and became colonel of the 8th Virginia Regiment. Ministers turned the colonial resistance into a righteous cause and served at every level in the conflict, from military chaplains to members of state legislatures to taking up arms and leading troops into battle. And ultimately, after two main British armies were captured by the Continental Army at Saratoga in 1777 and Yorktown in 1781, the other words of Patrick Henry to his fellow Virginians proved true. This is a word for us today. 3 millions of people armed with the holy cause of liberty, and in such a country as that which we possess, are invincible by any force which our enemy can send against us. It's time for us to cry out to God. It's time for us to hear his voice and do his will. Now, let me make this very clear. Anyone who has been reckless and lawless, injured property on any side of the political equation, Republican, Democratic, Antifa, Proud Boys, anybody that has defied authority, has destroyed property, has hurt people, and not emanated the love of God is in sin. And we need to be honest enough and forthright enough to say that sin does not sequester itself to one or another political party. Now, having said that, we have come through 4 years of an incredible articulation of Judeo-Christian policies that have made their way into practical benefit for this nation. And we do well to remember this. We've got 3 Supreme Court justices that we believe are pro-life. We have got a posture in this country that at least has been brought to a place of affirming life again. We've got a federal judiciary that has more constitutionalists than we've had maybe in the history of the country. We are stronger overseas from a military standpoint. We created a defense of our borders. These are things that emanate out of, we believe, biblical principles. Now, we don't know what the days ahead are, but we know God has a hold of what the days ahead are, and we also know this. As we yield to Him, He is going to help us. But I'm telling you this, the church in America has become weak. Ray Nino and I recently did a couple of programs. You may want to go back and look. Those programs were talking about what's gone wrong with the church in America, and I can tell you in a nutshell what's gone wrong. The church in America has become economically driven. The church in America has become entertainment driven. The church in America has pronounced to people, we'll create a salad bar approach to your faith. You pick what you like and don't pick what you like. You've heard me say this many times before. Lifeway Research, which is the research arm of the Southern Baptist, did a private study of pastors. And in that study, what did they find? They found that 50% of pastors were afraid to preach on sin. Why? Because they didn't want to offend the congregation. One of the great things about my church, Word of Faith Fellowship, is that we deal with sin. Sin is the reason Jesus came. Sin, you know, not being or doing what God requires. You know, that's original sin in the Garden of Eden. It's what set things in motion that created God through an infinite stoop and condescension of sending Jesus, His only Son, here. God created a plan so that we could be reconciled to Him. But the world today is violently reacting against the laws of God. They're bending and changing the laws of nature. They're creating a sense that we, just like the people at the Tower of Babel, we will reach the heavens on our own accord. You know, you read the stories of people like Steve Jobs or Bill Gates or Elon Musk. Most of these people at the end of the day would say, we're self-made. They don't need God because they have created God in their own image. And you know what? One of the things that we're finding more and more too in the world that we're in is we're living in a world where because people are hopeless, they're looking for all kinds of ways to create artificial hope. You know, relationships in this country through divorce, people just hooking up with each other, creating spurious relationships here and there, all of that is a desire to fill a God-shaped hole that only Jesus can fill. We have a mental health crisis in America. You know, and I'll say this personally, one of our 4 children is dealing with severe addiction, heroin and meth addictions. And, you know, the fact of the matter is when people don't go to God's word, when they don't cry out for His help, what ends up happening is they go every other place to try to find an answer. And there are no answers that you're going to find except for the answer of Jesus. You know, we often make mention of the fact that if the fig tree doesn't blossom, as it says in Habakkuk, I'm still going to do God's work and will. I'm still going to praise Him. When I was young, I've told this story before too. Once in a Sunday school class at Baraka Baptist Church, they were going around the table and they were asking all the children, I think I was 8 or 9, what's your favorite Bible verse? And every single child said John 3:16 or Romans 8:28. John 3:16 or Romans 8:28. You know, all things work together for good or for God so loved the world. They came to me and said, Butch, what about you? And I said, Hebrews 11:13. And the teacher looked at me and thought I was making that up. So she said, quote the verse. And so I quoted the verse. And in that translation, the verse said, these all died in the faith, not having received the promise, but confessing from afar they were strangers and aliens on the earth, longing for their heavenly country. Now, they had me meet with a pastor because they thought, what is wrong with this 8 or 9-year-old that he's so melancholic at this young age? But the fact of the matter was, God planted that verse in my heart. And what is the truth that I live with even today? This earth is not our home. My pastor, Jane Whaley, who has been the most profoundly influential spiritual mentor in my life, having been exposed to Christian leaders around the world, has made it very clear to all of us, this earth is not our home. This is the testing ground for, are we going to find Jesus worth the knowing? Are we going to be born again? And we want to bring everyone with us that we can. And so we share his light and his love. How do we do that? We do it by laying down our lives for others. We, as a church, have been in a profoundly impactful study for a couple of months of what does it mean to love God? And scripture is so full of examples. If we're cutting people off, if it's my four and no more, if it's we don't like those people, we only like these people, we don't have the love of God in us. God made it very clear that love is a barometer of what's happening in our heart. Are we loving people? That's the call in the days ahead. And we can keep conviction and love. It doesn't mean that we bend our conviction. It doesn't mean that we adjust to the world. You know, one of the things that happened with the early missionaries after World War II, many of the men, mostly men, who made what they called foxhole conversions, told God, if you get me out of this, I'll give my life to you. And so many of the missionaries coming out of World War II were actually veterans. Many of them were. And some of those missionaries would go to countries and they would think that they needed to adapt to the culture. And so Wycliffe Bible translators, for example, would come back after a year and they would find their American missionary with deer bones around their neck and wearing a loincloth. Why? Because they thought they needed to adapt to the culture. The Word of God does not need us to dress it up. We don't have to try to make the Word of God fashionable. We don't have to try to make it relevant. You know, we've got more versions of the Bible than any nation in the world. You can find a motorcycle rider's Bible, and you can find a trucker's Bible. You know, God's Word doesn't need to be dressed up and adorned. It is sharp, and it is powerful, and when you let it do its surgical work in your life will change. I am a living testimony to what can begin to happen when you yield everything to Jesus. All to Jesus I surrender. Not Jesus, you can have these three rooms in the house of my life. No, Jesus said, I want the keys, I want all of it. And in my case, he said, I'm going to demolish the house that you created, Butch, because without me, you can do nothing. Without me, you'll surely fail. You know, my mother, who's 88 years old, has the best oatmeal raisin cookies in the world. But they're that way because she follows the recipe. This is the recipe. She's entrusted me with it. God has given us the recipe for how to live life. We can't truncate it. We can't cut it. We can't piecemeal it. We have to take the whole of his word. And when we do that, our world, our neighborhood, our family, and our lives will change. And so during these perilous days that we're in, what would be the clarion call? The clarion call is cry out to Jesus, hear his voice, and immediately do his will. Because as you do that, you will proclaim to an increasingly dark world that there is hope and there is health and there is life, but only through following the path of Jesus Christ. It's been a joy to be with you today. You can find more of our testimonies and teachings at www.wordoffaithfellowship.org. 8:30 to 9, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on 100.9 FM and 590 AM WCAB. Find Jesus worth the knowing today. I promise you, as you yield your heart completely to him, you will exchange your life that you cannot keep for a life that will be forever. God bless you, Rutherford County.